Oh, wait a minute. Hold the thought.
Maybe piano is a good fortune on you for you. Thank you.
There we go.
Thank you.
time I see you, all your goodness shines through. I can feel this blessing rising up in you.
That I live, Jesus.
with all my heart, I worship you. All I have within me, I give you praise. All that I adore is in you.
Send one more song, and then Mike can come up, and we'll end with one more. Surround me with your love.
loved you always, always, forevermore. I am yours. And I love you always, always, forevermore. I am yours. You spread your arms to receive me, to retrieve me. You gave your life.
As he brings forth the word. And Lord, again, let us apply it to our lives and let us walk it out, for we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Lord, we just thank you that we can be in your house tonight. We thank you that we are free. We can worship you. I ask that you just bless each and every one of us that are here, and for those watching, that you just continue to protect us and bless our family, friends, and loved ones, and continue to draw us closer to yourself. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
So good evening, everybody. Thanks for coming tonight.
Praise God.
For those watching online, welcome. Today's the last Wednesday of 2023. As the new year brings new opportunities, it's common for many of us to make a new year's resolution. Some people go on diets for the new year, or they might try quitting smoking. Some people give up.
Sorry.
No, you're fine. Hey, it's working. My hope and prayer is that we can keep our hearts, our minds, our souls, and our spirits on Jesus this new year. Jesus said in Matthew 6, 33 through 34, if anybody would like to read.
But seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added to you. Therefore, do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will worry about its own things. Sufficient for the day is its own trouble.
Amen. Yes. Amen. Sounds straightforward, but how do we actually do that? We need to seek the kingdom of God. Sounds easy enough, but how do we actually go about doing it? How can we not have worries about tomorrow? How can we keep our mind on heavenly things and not on everything going on around us? One thing I'm trying to do this year is to actually stick to a reading plan, reading the Bible in a year. I've tried to do it many times, but I either jump around or I get behind. I've gone through this full Bible, but I've never actually done the Bible in a year on an actual reading plan. So that's what I'm trying to do to stay closer this year. Staying in the Word daily is a must for the year 2024. This new year will be the closest that all of us have been to the return of Jesus. We are seeing signs all over the place. One of the biggest signs that has yet to happen, it could happen after the rapture, I'm not trying to debate that, but it's Matthew 24:14, that the gospel will be preached to all people all over the world and then the end will come. With the advent of AI and supercomputers, there's now no need for people to painstakingly translate scriptures into native tongue. The computers can do it way faster, and basically we just need to get to the people that haven't heard the gospel.
Wow.
The AI is kind of doing things that we never really thought you could do, you know, 10 years ago. One of the things that's really been on my heart lately is that so many people that I know and love are walking around living their best life while having no real idea that there's a war going on for their souls. And not knowing that no man can serve two masters. Mm-hmm. So not only this year do we need to seek the kingdom of God and his righteousness, but we need to sow seeds, or continue to sow seeds. Some ways that we can seek the kingdom of God daily is praying without ceasing. Mm-hmm. We see that in 1 Thessalonians 5:17. We know prayer is super important. Jesus modeled the continual connection to the Father. Not only did he pray with many people and in groups, but he also spent time alone with God. And during those solitary moments with his Father, we know an intimate communion between the two of them was going on, like we see in Matthew 26:39. Somebody wants to read, I think I put that one.
He went a little farther and fell on his face and prayed, saying, "Oh, my Father, if it is possible, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not as I will, but as you will."
Amen. So that opportunity is there for us too, to be intimate with the Father. Being in another thing that we have to do, that we talked about, is being in the Word. It's easy enough to rely on our pastor or other spiritual leaders to feed us God's Word, as many of them have wonderful insight. But our Father wants us to meet personally with him as often as possible. Why rely solely on man when something much more personal remains available? According to Psalm 119:9, God gave us his word so that we can keep our way pure. It's a light unto our path and a lamp for our feet. According to Psalm 119:105, that might be that part. When we read and know the Bible and the promises of God, we are strengthened to stand firm against sin. Because we have spent time with him through his word, our relationship deepens. This is the means of seeking first God's kingdom. Next, we have worship. Worship can have many forms. As I was heading to my family's house for Christmas, me and Lauren were listening to worship songs, Hillsong, I think, on Pandora. And, man, sometimes it's like the love of God hits you so hard. And I just couldn't stop but crying. And it's crazy how that happens sometimes when you least expect it. But being in worship, listening to good music, staying focused is what we all need to continue to do for this new year. The fact that he loves us so much that he died for us while we were still sinners is amazing. Worship is supposed to be intimate, simply recognizing God as the Almighty and honoring him for who he is. If you're not sure what to do or sing, try reading and praying a psalm. Next we have repentance. John the Baptist preached, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is here." We all must admit that we are sinners and we all fall short. God still loves us. He loves every person on earth. His desire that all be saved and all come to him, whether it's for the initial repentance leading to salvation or daily heart check after salvation. Anytime, like Todd said, that you feel like you did something wrong, repent as soon as possible. Don't let it continue on. Just get rid of it right away. Give it to him. It's much easier that way than harboring things. And then you give the enemy a foothold, and it just becomes a real more difficult thing to get rid of. The big thing in Teen Challenge was scripture memorization. I can't remember how many scriptures they made us memorize, but probably 50 or more. At first, I didn't realize why we were doing it, but there is a certain peace that comes to the believer when God's word is written on the tablet of your heart. Mm-hmm. It helps focus on the kingdom, and it also takes away anxiety about the things of the world, especially memorizing the promises of God. Isaiah 41:10. Write that down. Somebody wants to read that one.
Fear not, for I am with you. Be not dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you. Yes, I will help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand.
Amen. Yes. Another reason why memorizing scripture can be super helpful is if you are struggling with something and you can't find a scripture, you can find a scripture that can help you. An example is if you are struggling with talking too much or speaking out, James chapter 3 is full of good scriptures regarding the tongue and the power of the spoken word. Mm-hmm. Then we have praise. We know people, we all like to be praised, so can you imagine how much more God does? We see in Psalm 100 verse 4 that we enter into his courts with praise. We draw into his presence that way. Psalm 22:3 tells us that God inhabits the praises of his people. Often we are convicted or stirred to action during praise. And finally, thanksgiving. Psalm 104 verse 4 indicates we enter his gates with thanksgiving in our heart. Thanksgiving plays a role in God's kingdom. And with wisdom we are, with God's kingdom, sorry. We often, we must praise him always and know that he will turn an otherwise bad situation into something positive. There is always light in the morning. If we work on these seven areas continually this year, we will find ourselves in the midst of the kingdom of God and his righteousness. We'll be focused on his kingdom and allowing him to be in control. So, as far as sowing seeds, we know Jesus talked a lot about sowing seeds, mustard seed, the parable of the sower, the parable of the soils in Luke. In Matthew 13:3-9, somebody wants to read that.
Then he spoke many things to them in parables, saying, behold, a sower went out to sow, and as he sowed, some seed fell by the wayside, and the birds came in to devour them. Some fell on stony places, where they did not have much earth, and they immediately sprang up because they had no depth of earth. But when the sun was up, they were scorched. And because they had no root, they withered away. And some fell among thorns, and the thorns sprang up and choked them. But others fell on good ground and yielded a crop. Some 100-fold, some 60, some 30. He who has ears to hear,
so we see Jesus telling an earthly story with heavenly meaning. Jesus was always trying to take heavenly ideas and thoughts and turn them into an earthly story that he could explain to many different people at once. This story is more about the ground than the seed and the person who is planting the seed. The closer we draw near to the kingdom, the better acquainted we shall be with the gospel mysteries. The disciples, after hearing Jesus say that, they asked Jesus about it, and they asked why he spoke to them in parables. And Jesus said, to you it has been given to know the secrets of the kingdom of heaven, but to them it has not been given. For to the one who has, more will be given, and he will have an abundance. But from the one who has not, even what he has will be taken away. This is why I speak to them in parables, because seeing they do not see, and hearing they do not hear, nor do they understand. Indeed, in their case, the prophecy of Isaiah is fulfilled that says, you will indeed hear but never understand, and you will indeed see but never perceive. For this people's heart has grown dull, and with their ears they can barely hear, and their eyes they have closed, lest they should see with their eyes and hear with their ears, and understand with their heart, and turn, and I would heal them. But blessed are your eyes, for they see, and your ears, for they hear. For truly I say to you, many prophets and righteous people long to see what you see, and did not see it, and to hear what you hear, and did not hear it. So we see here that it was given to the disciples to know the mysteries of the kingdom of heaven, but to the other people it was not given. So there are those who this knowledge is given and those who this knowledge is not given. We know that man can receive nothing unless it be given to him from above, John 3:27. We also know God is no debtor to man. His grace is his own. He gives or withholds it at pleasure, Romans 11:35. We also know God, when he is dispensing gifts, he bestows more on those who are using them, and he can take away from those who bury them. Getting back to the parable of the sower, let's see how Jesus explains the parable to his disciples. Matthew 13:18-23. Yeah, got that right. Somebody want to read that?
Therefore, hear the parable of the sower. When anyone hears the word of the kingdom and does not understand it, then the wicked one comes and snatches away what was sown in his heart. This is he who received seed by the wayside. But he who received the seed on stony places, this is he who hears the word, immediately receives it with joy, yet he has no root in himself, but endures only for a while. But when tribulation or persecution arises because of the word, immediately he stumbles. Now he who receives seed among the thorns is he who hears the word, and the cares of this world and the deceitfulness of riches choke the word, and he becomes unfruitful. But he who receives seed on the good ground is he who hears the word and understands it, who indeed bears fruit and produces some 100-fold, some 60, some 30.
So isn't it interesting that Jesus uses four different kinds of soil or people to tell this story?
This means I'm like dirt.
They all seem to hear the gospel. So we have four different types of people. All four of them hear the gospel, hear the word. They understand it. They all seem to hear the gospel and understand it. Here we have the first. So the first person is the one that hears the word of the kingdom and does not understand it. The evil one comes and snatches away what has been sown in his heart. They haven't been properly discipled. They probably weren't around enough good, godly people. They probably definitely weren't going to church. And Satan just came and grabbed them. So, but they could have followed after the truth. And then we have the second type. Again, they hear the word and receive it with joy, yet again, lacking in discipleship, mentorship, maybe not joining a body of believers. They hold on for a while in their own power, but the worries of the world, the tribulation of the world, pulls them away. Then we have the next type, those who hear and believe. They have one foot in the kingdom and one foot in the world. The lies of the enemy causes them to be unfruitful, double-mindedness. No man can serve two masters. Finally, we get to the last one. This type hears the word and understands it. This process is not merely an intellectual one. The person takes it in, discerns its meaning, they hear the word and receive it in an honest and good heart. Even still, there are degrees, different degrees, which are symbolized by bearing fruit, some 100-fold, some 60, some 30, varying according to the person's capacities and opportunities and what God dishes out. The other thing that's very interesting is that I can relate with each type. When I was going over this, like, I've read it a lot, but I've never actually, like, kind of really digested it, so to speak. And there's been times in my life where I was young and I was told about the gospel, but I didn't really get discipled and I didn't understand, like, the first person. Then there was another time when I was, like, in OLV or Catholic school where I knew more, but yet I didn't really get grounded. And then there's been other times in my life where I've had one foot in the church and one foot serving God and one foot in the world. So it's interesting that these are for people that hear the word. They're not like non-believers, or it's one in four. So according to this, thankfully, we serve a God of second chances. If we repent and wholeheartedly turn away from our sinful ways on a daily basis and do our best to keep our head and our hands on the plow moving forwards, we can become one of those who hear the word and understand it and bear much fruit, or continue to be somebody who understands it and bears much fruit. I think that's what we're all striving for, to hear those words, "Well done, my good and faithful servant." So as we all get ready to walk into this new year of 2024, let us keep our eyes on the prize. Let's fight the good fight, finish the race, so we can all get the crown of life. Seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and continue to bless seeds. God bless you all. Amen.
Amen. Hallelujah. Direct us, you watch over us, and thank you, Lord, that you love us. Help us to live lives that are pleasing to you, Lord, and not drift with the tide.
There is none like you.
Ask, Father God, that you help us to seek first your kingdom above all else, for everything else you'll take care of. And Lord, we also ask that you'll help us to be in the Word, to seek your face, to pray, to praise you, and to tell others about you daily, for we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
I'm just going to